So joining us today, our guest speaker, Professor Pankaj Jain. He is an internationally recognized academic leader in sustainability, Jain studies, film studies, and diaspora studies. He is a professor of philosophy and religious studies and is heading Indic studies at FAME University, Pune. Earlier, he was the founding co-chair of India Initiatives Group and associate professor in the Department of Philosophy and Religion at the University of North Texas, a Taiwan American university. He holds a PhD from the University of Iowa and an MA from Columbia University, both in religious studies. His BE was in computer science from Karnataka University, India. Professor Jain has over 25 years of work experience in both academia and industry. He is currently working on his fourth monograph, Modern Jainism, a historical approach, co-editing the Encyclopedia of Hinduism, and a volume of Indian and Western philosophical concepts in religion. In addition, he compiled Jain's and Hindus' history in America for his third monograph, Dharma in America, A Short History of Hindu-Jain Diaspora. He is also the author of the award-winning Dharma and Ecology of Hindu Communities, Sustenance and Sustainability, and Science and Socio-Religious Revolution in India, Moving the Mountains. His articles and quotes have appeared in several academic journals and on the Huffington Post, Washington Post, Times of India, Speaking Tree, and Patheos. In addition, Dr. Jain is widely quoted in various American and Indian media outlets. In July 2020, the New York Times interviewed him. And in 2019, Morgan Freeman interviewed him for the section on Jainism in the National Geographical series, The Story of God. He is a recipient of the Fulbright Nehru Fellowship for Environmental Leadership and Wenner-Gren Grant, among many other grants. In addition, he was nominated for the Sustainability Leadership Award for Memnosin Institute. It is our privilege to have you here, Professor Jain. Over to you.
Thank you, Ms. Sharma. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Ms. Sharma. Thank you, Dr. Uma Shankar and the colleagues and staff at SIES College. As I was mentioning, I used to live in Kurla many years ago, so it brings all the memories back as I'm speaking to you all in Sion through this virtual link that Microsoft Teams has provided us. The topic that was given to me is Jainism and sustainability, which has been a topic close to my heart, academic heart, as well as personal life living in America for last more than two decades here. Many things, as ma'am was referring to, I think many things are still not fully explored that are coming from Jainism or Hindu, even Hinduism, Buddhism. All three are not as explored widely in America, especially as other religions are. But even among Indic traditions, Jainism remains even minority among minorities in America. So today, let's and within India also, in especially in philosophy departments, I think across India, Jainism is relatively less known. So it's nice to be able to share what I have discovered all these years teaching, researching, living, observing Jain community and writing about Jain community over the last several years. I have compiled my thoughts in a presentation, so I'll share that with you now. So this is the title, this is the presentation that I would like to share with you, Dharma and Ecology. And this is a, you know, image or picture from not a temple in India, but a temple in Los Angeles, California. So now Jains are at least 100,000 Jains, 1 lakh Jains are in America, and they have built magnificent temples across America now, almost 100 temples in America that are dedicated to Jainism, over 1,000 temples that are dedicated to Hinduism also. But this is an image from a Californian Jain temple for you here. So before we begin, we have to, I would like to remind ourselves, including me, that when we discuss any topic in humanities, social sciences, most of the categories that we are applying are all coming from Western scholars, mostly speaking, especially when we are using English words, right? So what is happening is, as Susan Rodolph had coined this phrase called imperialism of categories, right? So which means that whatever categories that are being applied to non-Western traditions, such as Jainism or Hinduism or Buddhism, the categories are like this. So some examples of these categories that are being applied to us, Max Weber says that West is agentic, East is fatalistic. Talcott Parsons said, in the West, you achieve status by achievement, whereas in the East, the status comes by birth. John Stuart Mill similarly said, West is a mature civilization, East is a childlike civilization. These are the selections that were taken by Susan Randolph, and she claimed and she argued that these categories, these stereotypes, these biases are applied on non-Western cultures even today when we are doing humanities, social sciences, philosophy, and all of these subjects that we are doing. So even in this topic of Jainism and ecology, I try my best not to follow along the Western categories, but to be able to come up with alternative categories, alternative ways of looking at non-Western traditions such as Jainism and the rest. Right. So that's with that caveat. Let's now take the next slide. So if we look at this 2018 Environmental Performance Index, that ranking puts India at 177. This ranking says that India is doing very bad in terms of environmental performance. And although mostly Euro-American nations, Euro-American countries are doing much better than India because they have better air quality, better water quality, and so on. So that's one way of measuring the environmental performance. Right? Now, if we change our lens a little bit, if we change this perspective a little bit and try a different way of looking, different way of measuring environmental performance, here is an alternative way. What is this alternative way? This is coming from the National Geographic magazine. National Geographic did a Green Index survey of major economies from 2012 to 2018 and 2019. And what they found is that India is the greenest among all these major countries such as United States, Canada, Mexico, Russia, UK, France, Germany, Australia, Brazil, China. Compared to all other countries, India has the least carbon footprint. So India is the greenest. So the two ways of looking at the environmental performance right here can be really compared and contrasted, right? So one says India is at 177th rank because of the low air quality or poor water quality. But when it comes to carbon footprint, India is the greenest. Indian consumption or destruction of natural resources is the least compared to even China or Brazil, which are sometimes clubbed with India, BRICS countries, right? Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Even among BRICS countries, India is the best. India is the greenest. So how does this work? How did they come up with this new green index, in which the carbon footprint is much lower than many other countries? Of course, United States and Canada and Russia and England and Germany and France are even worse because their carbon footprint is very, very heavy because of the heavy consumption, heavy utilization of natural resources. That puts them even, you know, much worse than Indian performance. So totally two different ways of measuring environmental performances. Now looking at the Green Index a bit more, what does that have to do with Jainism? So coming to this slide now, what I found in my research is that if you look at the Indian practices of vegetarianism, for example, Indian low meat consumption, or Indian habits of minimizing the resources. You know, even today when we think of buying new furniture, for example, or buying anything new for that matter, we try to minimize our requirements, definitely our wants. More and more Indians have been minimizing their requirements, their needs, their wants, and minimizing the meat consumption also for centuries in India. Both these practices are rooted in dharmic teachings of Jainism and Hinduism and Buddhism also. Now look at these two graphs to make it even more clear what I'm trying to say. Look at these two graphs. So meat consumption by selected country. If we see from 1961 to 2013, Indian meat consumption has been even lower than Kenya, definitely lower than China, UK, Canada, Brazil, and US. All of you can see this graph, right? I hope. Is this clear on the left side?
Yes, sir.
All right, good. And then the other graph that you see on the lower left corner of your screen, here this is the graph for passenger car density in 2009. So if you see in Italy, for example, there are 600 cars for every 1,000 people. Yes, right. Then Germany has almost 500 cars for every 1,000 people. India as late as in 2009 is at the lowest level, maybe like 10 cars for every 1,000 people, even less than China, less than Indonesia, South Africa, Mexico, Brazil. All of those countries have much more, many, many more cars than in India. Now, this is not just about the, it is not just that we are still a developing nation, but I think it also shows that if there is a chance, if there is a possibility, in one family, people would still like to do carpooling, and three or four people in the family would still like to do carpooling and still like to use public transport. That is the way Indian culture has had evolved for centuries and millennia. If we can do without meat consumption, we are very happy with our lentils and wheat and rice and fruits and vegetables. If our public transport works and if carpooling works, we are very happy not to have one car per person in family, which is very common, for example, in America. So what these two habits are showing us is that it's not just because of the money, financial resources, but it is also because of the cultural habits that we have maintained these habits for a long time. Even our millionaires and billionaires would lead very simple life, would go walking to their workplaces, would donate their wealth for charity and so on. So these two habits that can be included as part of dharmic ecology, which keeps our carbon footprint low, are actually called as empty belly environmentalism. This is the term that was used by a very senior scholar, Ramachandra Guha and John Martinez earlier in their 2013 book, in which they say that empty belly environmentalism actually works for the environment. It's helpful for the environment. It is to be celebrated. It is to be adopted. So that's coming from traditions such as Jainism and Buddhism and Hinduism. Now, when it comes to, so I already linked two of the practices with Jainism. So now if we take an even deeper look into Jain cosmology, what it teaches us, what it shows us is that Jain cosmos is made of this kind of a shape in which a human being is standing, apparently, with his or her hands on the back, on the central region of the body. And the uppermost region is the Siddhaloka, which is the home of liberated beings. Between the uppermost layer and the center layer are the seven heavens. And below the central region are the hells. So Siddhaloka, then the Devloka, and then the mid-level is the home of humans and animals. And then down below is the Naraka, home of hellish beings. So Siddhaloka, then Swargas, and then the earth, and then the narakas. And then outside this universe is the aloka, which is the space outside of the universe. So outside of the universe, aloka is infinite, even in Jain cosmology. But loka, the universe, is limited, is finite. So that is the Jain cosmology. To look at these bullet points on your left, Siddhaloka, then eight heavens, then the Manushyaloka has three continents, two oceans, animals and humans. Then below the Manushyaloka, below the earth region, is the seven hells. And all of this universe is filled with living beings, which are the jivas, which are the souls. And souls have consciousness, energy, and bliss. And then there are non-living beings, which are the karma particles. So all this cosmology, what it tells us is that all the beings are interconnected in one way or the other because of the cycle of rebirth, cycle of transmigration or punarjanam, in which one's present can be linked with others' past or future. So because of this interlinked souls that are in the universe, the Jain Siddha, Jain Loka, that is why the Jain seers, Jain Tirthankars, or Jain sages, they advocated for vegetarianism because we are all connected. So we have no right to kill other beings because they are also connected with us through the cycle of transmigration. So Jain cosmology then indirectly inspires Jains to remain vegetarian more than almost 3,000 years now. And with this influence, with their influence, largely Indian population overall, because of Buddhism and Hinduism, also kept their meat consumption very less compared to other countries. So that is the link with Jain cosmology and the habits that Jains have prevailed for many, many millennia. Now, another look at why Jains have been vegetarians for 3,000 years. The Jain taxonomy says that all the beings in the universe can be categorized into five categories. First category says the beings that have only one sense of touch only. What are those beings? Those are the earth-bodied beings, water-bodied beings, fire and air bodies, Nigoda, which is the one cell unit such as amoeba, and plants. All of these have only one sense, and these are immobile beings. So notice that earth, water, fire, and air are also considered living beings with souls. They also have souls. Then the next category is of touch and taste. The beings that have two sense, two senses, that is worms, leeches, oysters, and snails. These have two senses. Then the beings that, such as insects and spiders, that have three senses, touch, taste, and smell. Then next comes the beings such as butterflies, flies, and bees that have four senses, touch, taste, smell, and see. Then finally, the beings that are sentient and non-sentient, in which there we have birds, reptiles, mammals, humans, gods, and demons. These have five senses. So birds, so notice that humans are equated with mammals. Humans are equated with reptiles, birds, gods that are in swargas, and demons that are in narakas. So from Jain argument, from Jain philosophical perspective, for our survival, for our consumption, if you're killing a mammal, such as, let's say, a goat, or if you're killing a bird, such as a chicken, or if you're consuming any other being that is on this category of five senses, it is equal to killing a human being. So that is why meat consumption was prohibited, because of this taxonomy that Jains came up with. And this I've taken from 11th century text by Shanti Suri called Jeev Vichar Prakaranam. This is the first time that was categorically mentioned in 11th century that human beings have no privilege. Human beings are same as that are mammals or reptiles or birds or even gods or demons when it comes to senses. They can be sentient or non-sentient, but humans beings are not to be do not have any privilege to kill a reptile or a mammal or a bird for their human consumption. What they can consume is only one sense being, that is, they have only touch sense, the sense of touch. So for human survival or human consumption, you can take little bit of earth, minimal of water. So do not even waste earth resources, do not waste water resources, do not waste fire resources or energy resources, do not waste air resources, and do not kill those plants that are by which you are killing the entire plant. So Jains have avoided killing even a plant that is such as carrot or potato, onion, garlic. Many Jains are still not consuming those food, because those are coming from the roots or stems of the plants. So you have no right to kill the entire plant. What you are supposed to take is only the byproduct of a plant, such as maybe fruit that is falling off of a tree, or some grains or lentils or wheat. So minimize violence even in your consumption of plants. Minimize violence even in your consumption of air, fire, water, or earth. That is a Jain argument why they have remained vegetarians for almost 3,000 years. So only one sense beings are to be consumed, to be used. And even among one sense beings, be very careful as you think of consuming any plant that is coming as a root or a stem. So I hope that summarizes the Jain argument for vegetarianism and how it connects, how it links with the with our carbon footprint, which is very less. That is why the Green Dex Index puts India as one of the greenest economies in the world, because of the less meat consumption. And this is the argument that is in the heart of the practices such as vegetarianism by Jains, especially. All right. So Jainism is also called a religious tradition with three A's: ahimsa, aparigraha, and anekantvad. These are the main pillars of Jain philosophy: ahimsa, nonviolence. So nonviolence teaches that one's the greatest dharma that one can have for earth, for nature, is to be nonviolent. So by nonviolence, ahimsa parmo dharma is the biggest quotation that Jains quote all the time. This is the greatest dharma for one's karma. So if our actions are nonviolent, that can be our greatest dharma for nature, for earth and for nature. So that is the first teaching, first philosophical principle that comes from Jainism. Aparigraha means non-accumulation. So non-accumulation means cut down on your needs, cut down on your wants, minimize the resources that are utilized for your consumption, for your survival. So that again correlates with nature, for earth, that your less consumption, less utilization of resources automatically leads into less and less carbon footprint. That is all. So that means more and more more awareness for living environmentally friendly. Then anekantvad, which can be translated as many-pointedness, that is usually illustrated or exemplified by the story of an elephant and six blind men, or you know, six blind human beings that are trying to touch the elephant, and everybody thinks that the elephant is like a trunk, like a tail, like his belly, or like his ear, but everybody has a partial perspective. And only by combining all the six perspectives, they get the final truth, final reality of the, you know, comprehensive, the reality of the elephant. Similarly, reality in nature, reality in earth is also very comprehensive. And we all have very limited perspectives. So Jain view says, Jain philosophy says that we should combine all the perspectives because reality always exists in plurality. So Professor Arvind Sharma, I'm quoting here, he says that plurality of reality equates with reality of plurality. Only with these multiple perspectives, if we combine them, then we come to the final reality. How does it translate into sustainability? Is that human being, human-centric view is only one perspective. Humans have no monopoly or no privilege over consuming the natural resources because elephants or animals or other animals, or other birds, insects, reptiles, they also have equal rights to use the same natural resources. So instead of forcing human view on other species, we should combine all the perspectives. That is the way to live with more humility by accepting more perspectives and not just to force one's own perspective as the final reality. So that these are the triple A's of three, Ahimsa, Parigraha, Anekantvad. These are very important for Jain practitioners, but they also can be correlated with environmentally friendly lives that are to be lived by based on these three principles. Now, the Jain role models are coming from their Tirthankaras. Jain Tirthankara, Tirthankar is the word, which is sometimes translated as ford maker. And Mahavir was last Tirthankar, but before Mahavir was Parshvanath. Before Parshvanath was Neminath. So 22nd Tirthankar or ford maker was Neminath. And all of these role models that Jains have followed, they all responded to some violence being done to animals or reptiles. And out of that compassion, they changed their lifestyle completely. They were all born as princes. They were all living wealthy life, royal life, but they all renounced their royal life. They all renounced their kingdoms and wealth and family. And they all became ascetics. They all renounced even their clothing to that extent. So Neminath responds to animal slaughter and becomes a monk. Parshvanath responds to the burning of a snake and becomes a monk. Mahavir responds to cattle slaughter even as he's dying, even as at his last breath, he sends his most favorite disciple to stop some cattle slaughter happening somewhere in that village, around their village in Pavapuri, Bihar, present-day Bihar, where he passed away. In one of his statements, he said that trees are inherently valuable in Acharang Sutra in chapter 2 and 4.2.1. Long before science came up with this statement, Mahavir had already said in Acharang Sutra, also in chapter 1, that vegetation has life just as humans. So, you know, imagine these environmentally conscious statements that are coming from all these Tirthankars, role models for, you know, thousands of years before modern science came up with these kind of statements to worry about biodiversity or to worry about vegetation, plants and whatnot. Similarly, other texts of Jain say that souls render service to one another in Tattvar Sutra, for example, and even in Bhagavati Sutra. So what it means is that we are not disconnected from other souls. We all should support, should help each other. We should serve each other. That is the way to live environmentally friendly life. And in Dashvaikalika Sutra, there is another statement which says that human beings should live like bees. Just as bees collect only small nectar from each flower instead of destroying the entire flower, if we take that lesson from bees, we will also take very minimal that is needed for our bare minimum survival from nature. Instead of destroying the nature, instead of destroying an entire plant, instead of destroying an entire mountain, for example, or entire water body, we'll take only minimal what is needed. That we should learn from bees, and that is the way to live in this world. In Adi Puran, another statement is very interesting, in which they say that forests are like saints, and we should plant trees for good karma. So tree plantation was being advocated by Jain texts hundreds and hundreds of years before modern science also took it up, and we are now encouraging planting of tree across the world now. So these are some of the, you know, great role models in the texts and in the history and in other texts that I thought I'll share that are very environmentally friendly that we get from Jainism. Now, so Jain role models we saw, Jain texts we saw, even Jain householders, if you look at Jain householder lives, what kind of professions they lead. This is coming from Bhogo Pabhog Vrata, another text that is coming from Jainism, in which they say that most Jain householders are prescribed to do jobs such as trading or banking or commercial activities, clerical activities, diamond trading or traditional medicine, arts and crafts, government or ruler kind of profession, manufacturing activities, textiles or machines, publishing or media, education, these are all to be done by Jain householders. What is not to be done, what is really prohibited by Jains, is they cannot do charcoal, trading of charcoal, trading of timber, pulling animals in carts, trading of alcohol, or slave trading, weapons trading. Poisons are not to be utilized in any of their professions. Sugar canes or seeds are also prohibited. Firearms or fire trade is also prohibited. And even lay construction was prohibited for Jain householders for centuries. So again, the emphasis is on relatively non-violent professions and careers, and more violent professions, at least more tangibly violent professions, were always prohibited for Jain householders over centuries that we get for householders from the Jain texts. Then if you compare Jain philosophical ideas with modern scientific or modern philosophical perspectives, Brian Swim is a contemporary philosopher, environmental philosopher. And according to Brian Swim, material objects leads to consumerism. Consumerism leads to depression. Now his view matches very well with Jain Aparigraha, which says the similar thing, that we should always try to cut down on our accumulation, cut down on our possession. That is the way to live a Jain Aparigraha-based life with minimum needs, minimum wants. Similarly, Brian Swim says Earth is alive and Earth responds to our presence. Now that goes very well with the Jain idea that Earth-bodied beings also have souls, and earth and water, air, and so on. Similarly, Brian Swim says we should celebrate Big Bang, the event of Big Bang, because Big Bang is where we all, entire cosmos came out of Big Bang. So we are all connected with single origin event, right? So we are all to be sort of that single event makes us all siblings, the entire cosmos, because we all came out of Big Bang. Now that goes also very well with Jain respect for all jivas, because all jivas have souls. All souls want to live. Nobody likes to be hurt. And because of the transmigration or punarjanam, all the beings are also interconnected in the entire cosmos. So that goes also very well with what Brian Swim is saying, the Big Bang theory and the universal celebration of origin. Similarly, Thomas Berry says that Thomas Berry and David Abram are two contemporary philosophers also. Berry says world is a communion of subjects, not a collection of objects. Right? Everything or even every being has an agency. They all want to remain freedom. They want to celebrate their liberty. Nobody likes to be treated as an object. And that goes very well with Jain view of soul in all beings, even including earth, water, air, and fire, and so on. So treat them also as if they are living beings. They also have souls. So do not just use them as an object. That goes very well with Thomas Berry's statement. Abram similarly says diversity of local forms is to be celebrated. And that goes well with Jain insistence of changing lifestyle, becoming more and more non-violent. Mahavir says we should change minds, not force change upon people, but try to inspire them by changing their minds. Trees as inherently valuable for beauty and strength. That goes also well with what Abram has been saying. Then David Abram says role of senses is also to be appreciated, to be acknowledged. And that goes very, very well with empiricism that is taught in Tattvar Sutra by Uma Swati, in a most celebrated Jain text written in Sanskrit, accepted both by Digambars and by Shvetambars. That goes well with what David Abram has been saying, role of senses. So these are the three Western philosophers I thought I'll compare with Jain philosophical traditions and how they can be compared, they can be matched with what Jainism has been saying. Then the modern contribution, the biggest contribution of Jainism, I guess, can be seen by Srimad Rajchandra, who lived in Gujarat from 1867 to 1901. And he corresponded with Mahatma Gandhi. When Mahatma Gandhi was in South Africa, he had several spiritual dilemmas, questions, and doubts that he was not sure. So he used to write letters to Srimad Rajchandra from 1891 to 1895. They wrote many, many letters over these 6 years. And from Srimad Rajchandra's teachings, Mahatma Gandhi adopted many, many principles, many ideas, and that became the hallmark of his entire life. So inspired by Rajchandra, Gandhi took Satya, Ahimsa, Aparigraha, Brahmacharya, Purusharth, and Tapasya, all these, you know, translated into English, truth and nonviolence, simplicity, celibacy, self-reliance, austerities, all these ideas he really took from Srimad Rajchandra and from other texts as well, but Srimad Rajchandra was the closest that he came with, that he became close as a guru, as a spiritual guru. Although he did not accept him, he did not declare that Srimad Rajchandra is my guru, but by the influence, by the correspondence that they both had for 6 years, I think it can be seen that Srimad Rajchandra had the biggest influence on Mahatma Gandhi, and Gandhi took these ideas, and that became not just for his life, but the entire movement that he led against the British Raj. Now, if you look at Gandhi's life, and this I'm taking from Professor Vinay Lal at UCLA in California, and he says that Gandhi's life can be seen as an ecological treatise. Gandhi's meals was very small meals. Gandhi would practice these mon vratas, these silence vows for an extended period of time. Gandhi would always walk, almost like a Jain monk or a Jain nun. His walking was his meditation. He would dictate his letters to his colleagues, and his daily walks, his morning walks or evening walks were very prominent in his entire life. He cultivated the small with the big. If you remember the Gandhi film, the Hollywood Gandhi film, here is the big meeting going on with Subhash Jawaharlal Nehru and Sardar Patel and all. And Gandhi would leave that meeting and take care of the small goat, because goat is hurt and his leg is hurting. Gandhi would take care of the goat first and then come back to the meeting, cultivation of the small. Spinning wheel, Gandhi's entire, many images, especially in India, we have seen Gandhi's always seen in this spinning wheel. Now, spinning wheel was a big statement that I will make my own clothing. Instead of just criticizing the British corporate policies, I will live a life that would become exemplary, become a role model, that I can live a life which is self-reliant. I can make my own clothes. So that became a statement of Swadeshi for entire Indian population at that time in 40s and 30s and 40s. And then abhorrence of waste. Gandhi's son apparently lost a small piece of pencil one night, and Gandhi lost his sleep for the entire night. That where did I go wrong, that my son is not recognizing the importance of a small piece of pencil? Why, how can he waste that? How can he lose that? So that kind of an abhorrence of waste, now we are only waking up to that now when the environment is so severely stressed, that especially in America, now people are realizing here that, we should minimize waste and so on. But Gandhi's life, Gandhi was a proto-environmentalist much ahead of his time. And his many things that he practiced were based in the principles that he learned from Srimad Rajchandra. So that I like to say that there is a sort of intangible link from Mahavir Swami to Srimad Rajchandra, from Srimad Rajchandra to Mahatma Gandhi, from Mahatma Gandhi to Dr. Martin Luther King in America and Nelson Mandela in South Africa. So this tradition of nonviolence and environmentally conscious life, nonviolent life, is the tradition going on from Mahavir to Mahatma Gandhi to Martin Luther King to Nelson Mandela. And so the relevance of nonviolence and environmentally conscious life will always remain relevant. It's always going to be relevant. And the Jain philosophy, Jain tradition has much to contribute. And Gandhi's example is one of the biggest examples that we have, and how he has inspired many other leaders across the world in South Africa and in America. In Jains in America, what they're doing as their practices, some things that they're doing is that their temples in California, Texas, New Jersey have all gone solar. So they are more and more using renewable energy, for example. They are also supporting cattle sanctuaries in America, just as Jains and Hindus have been supporting many, many thousands of cattle sanctuaries, Goshala, what we call, or Pinjar Pole, what we call in India, across India, thousands of such pinjar poles where even a sick cattle or a diseased cattle can also come and they will be taken care of. Something similar is happening now in America also, in Michigan, Colorado, New York, where there are these goshalas or cattle sanctuaries where cattle are treated with all the love and care. Jains are also very active in vegetarian societies across America, promoting vegetarianism in America. Many Jain youths are now becoming vegans, even beyond vegetarian. They are shunning even the dairy products. So they are becoming vegans across America and across the world now. So these are some of the things that Jains are still practicing across the world, even outside India. So this is just a summary of what I presented as a history of Jains in America. So first Jain to arrive in America was Veerchand Gandhi, who came with Swami Vivekananda in 1893. Jain temples, I already mentioned. Jainism is also becoming more popular in American universities. Jains are also active, leading in diamond trade in America, and in healthcare, as well as in many museums are now showing art historical objects also from Jains. These are some of the saints, male and female monks and nuns that have been prominent in last 200 years. That is all that I wanted to show. And now I'd love to take more of your questions that would make it even more interesting what I want to share, what I want to present to you. So I welcome your questions now.
Thank you, sir, for your enriching session. Now we can start our Q&A session. So students, if you have any questions, please ask Professor Jain.
Sure, yes. Or even from colleagues, faculty.
Yeah, yes.
Shall I have a question to you, Dr. Jain?
Sure.
Not a question. I'm just looking seriously. Of course, fantastic presentation, a wonderful panoramic view of what Jains have done it and what they've contributed across the world. Yeah, extremely intriguing. Why it is such a powerful philosophy like Ahimsa Paramo Dharma, constantly culturally so elevating in India, why is it taking so much time for people to imbibe and making it not, I wouldn't use the word glamorous or making it popular, but what is it that according to you are the reasons for not getting into, you know, into every nook and corner of the world? Why is the whole thing has been so gradually slow? Any particular reason that comes to your mind?
What do you mean? Can you elaborate a little bit more? What do you mean it's slow?
Slow in the sense like it's such a powerful philosophy, and already we are talking today about the planet is damaged and we have to now rectify it. The whole attitude of damaging or, you know, stripping the resources, which are all against our philosophy, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And it has happened in India also today, as much as you're talking about from in US. Here also the amount of waste, I will not be very generous in my comments saying that we are better than here also has been a lot of nonsense in Indian, among the Indians. Mm-hmm. And over a period of time, we have just woken up very slow. I think as a message, if you can give to the youngsters, we should not repeat those kind of mistakes or errors. Hold on to these values, very strongly and continue it, because these are the torchbearers that we have with us.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think you already summarized, ma'am, very nicely that we all have to get to learn these principles, philosophies more seriously. And as teachers, if we can share more and more with our students, they are the torchbearers for future. More and more understanding, more and more discussion on these topics like this, like what we are having now. I think we all have to learn from each other and we all have to practice these things. That is the way to say whatever is left. But thankfully, we still have some very powerful examples, really interesting examples that come from India. For example, India is the only country in the world other than African continent where we still have large mammals such as rhinoceros and lions. What is it in India that we can, with 1.4 billion people and such a small area, you know, compared to China or US or Russia, we are such a small country by area. So our resources are so severely limited. And yet we have these large beasts among us, lions and rhinoceros. Why they are all extinct from all the other rest of the countries? Africa is the exception, of course. What is it in us that as soon as you cross our national boundary, right? So I come from Rajasthan. If I cross the boundary of India and go to the other side, all those black bucks, deer, or other birds, flora and fauna is gone from other side. But in India, they're all still intact. If I went to Jaisalmer in 2018, it is still full of bushes. I still see rabbits and deer and black bucks. Full of them. Why? Because of people such as Bishnois that are fully vegetarians. They would fight with a Salman Khan or anybody else, not just Salman Khan. They have been fighting with so many hunters and poachers over centuries that they have made sure that all the flora and fauna in the desert, the Thar Desert is the most densely populated desert in the world. Why? Because we love to stay with our animals and birds.
Yeah.
Go to the other extreme of India. Go to other extreme of India. Go to the eastern side. If we go to, I've not yet been to Sundarbans. I would love to go. In Sundarbans, I've heard stories that even cannibals, even man-eating tigers, ma'am, are not to be killed by the people living in Sundarbans because of the Bon Bibi. Bon means one, forest. One becomes Bon in Bengali. Bibi means ma'am or Devi, right? Forest goddess, Bon Bibi. Because Bon Bibi rehti hai janglo mein, hum tiger ko nahi maar sakte. Even if those tigers are coming and hunting us, killing us, but tigers ke saath rehna hai humko. I went to Gir Forest, the lion forest in Gujarat, just 3 months back in Gujarat. And there what I found is that there is a community that lives with lions in the forest, Gir Forest. Because of this amazing harmony, amazing coexistence, we have been able to save our rhinoceros in Assam, our lions in Gir in Gujarat, and many, many others in Himalayas, for example. Chipko movement, another example I'll give you, Chipko movement in Himalayas, right? So we just lost Sundarlal Boguna, the great Gandhian philosopher, environmentalist.
Yeah.
And he and other leaders of Chipko, Chandri Prasad Bhatt and all, they could make sure, even with such a heavy pressure from our population, even today in Himalaya, thousands and thousands, millions of trees are intact. Up above a certain height, nobody has any right or privilege to cut any tree in Himalayas. Imagine the pressure that we have, our industrial pressure, our population. Why we can save our trees? Why we can save our animals? Because so many things we have still preserved, thanks to our traditions such as Jainism, Hinduism, Buddhism, and many other indigenous traditions, tribal traditions, Bhil community. I went to Bhil community villages, many, many, hundreds of, thousands of people living in these hundreds of villages. And in the middle of nowhere, there would be a small section of forest. And inside that forest, there is a small temple. The temple hai, mandir hai, toh ped nahi kaatne. If there is a temple, nobody will cut the tree. These are sacred groves across India, again, Kerala and across India. So many other things that is helping us. And we all have to make sure that we share with these great examples.
Continue this,
teach this, share this, so that we can preserve whatever is left. We still have so much to preserve. Yes.
Thank you,
ma'am.
I also liked your idea of, getting back to a minimalistic living, not to generally throw away the resources, whosoever's money it is, whether it's a father's money or the nation's money, or the nature's resource.
Exactly.
That attitude of minimalistic, I think it was a wonderful take-home lesson for all of us.
It is
students,
actually,
now it's all your turn.
For students, I would like to share this. Minimalism as a word is really catching fire in America. Yes. Youngsters, so-called millennials or Gen Z, right? They have this minimalistic attitude now. They don't like to buy huge houses. They live in a very small house and they're always mobile. Wherever they have opportunity, they like to move and they live in this minimalistic attitudes. So if you Google for minimalism, you'll get to know more American pages than Indian pages. So you make sure you Google for minimalism. Yes.
Dr. Kamala Srinivas from here, from Department of Philosophy, sir. Thank you for a wonderful, wonderful talk. In fact, let me also tell you that we have another paper in the 6 units philosophy that we teach at the third year level, which is called as Living Ethical Issues. And in that, environmental philosophy is dealt in greater detail. And there, we happen to engage with students with religious views. And they get to explore about the various religious views. And as you rightly pointed out through your talk, that how important it is to have a perspective from the background of religion to understand the concept of nature itself. And further to explore human nature as well as and ecology. So these are very emerging kind of environmental consciousness, which is in the work. My question to you is, having said that, having observed, made that observation through your presentation, my question to you is, we know that, yes, in America, as academicians and scholars, we know that in America, religious studies is, again, held very high. So we don't have, I don't think so, any university where we find philosophy, the word, featuring as frequently or as popularly as religious words is. So how do you think Indic studies or religious studies can benefit the Indian population in America? And as you have been teaching, how many students do you have for these subjects? And are they again Indian majority, or is it again other cultural background who are there? I would like to know that. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, very interesting question. Yes, religious studies or Department of Religions are actually spreading in America. All government-funded universities, public universities, have this Department of Religion. So where I have been teaching in Texas, for example, for a decade, this is a public university. And so there is a BA in religion, BA in philosophy also, and BA in religion also. So many universities here in America have these kind of departments. So they teach all religions there: Christianity, Judaism, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism. Jainism is a late entry, but they're also encouraging more and more Jainism studies as well here also. So students are, religion is a big, I guess, much bigger industry in America than in India, because religion and media and religion and politics is even more tightly integrated in America. So so many students will do BA in religion and then will go for MA in journalism. So yeah. Journalism and religion become a nice combination, and they make their career out of that. Yeah. So that's how, or many religious students, BA in religion, after that they will choose to become, their church leader. They will maybe get a MA or PhD in Christianity and become a church leader. So church is a heavily funded organization in America, and they will go out across the world, do their missionary activities. And so religion is much prominent and much more, organized. Because of organized religion, it has much more value for formal education, formal degree for religion in America than in India. India, religion is like a very personal choice, and it is not really, you cannot really make living out of religion. But in America, it's possible.
True. We can see that. So we have some scope for students if they seriously engage with religious studies. We have an applied component paper, comparative study of religions, and that's where we take on them from the most formal religions to the indigenous and the tribal. Take on onto that kind of an background then, or framework. And students, this is a reminder that you have an option to unmute and ask questions, please.
Sure.
Yeah, in fact, thank you, Kamala ma'am. I was just about to... Hello, sir. This is Vrishali Gupte, assistant professor from Department of Philosophy. And it was a wonderful, wonderful talk, sir. It was a pleasure listening to you. And as Kamala ma'am mentioned, we have comparative study of religions for the second year students. And yes, there we discuss about different religions. We compare religions based on their background, historical background, the ethics, the teachings, doctrine, tenets, all those things we compare and contrast. And we try to understand that religion in more depth, rather than the superficial understanding of what the religions, the religious people have, in today's times. So Jainism is one of the religion that we discuss in detail. And it was a wonderful, insightful kind of, understanding from your side, sir. And I'm sure that students are going to take that message home, and we are going to have a more engaging discussion in our classroom. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you.
Any questions from students' end? We would like to hear it out from your end.
Yeah.
What has today's lecture, given an impression to you? Because your impressions are very important. Shreya?
And Hindi is okay also. Hindi is my mother tongue, so okay. I don't mind.
They're fine.
Hindi.
They're fine because we communicate in English only. So,
okay.
A formal language.
Sir, I've got a question.
Great. Sure. Go ahead.
Sir, you just mentioned in the very beginning that India is one of the greenest, India's got a lot of greenery. So, in order to still we have got this problem of constant air pollution. So, Is it something related to culture of every state? We can say that culture of every state is also contributing in many good things and bad things. What's your take on this line?
Right. So, greenest, when I mentioned, this was the Green Deck survey that is done by National Geographic survey, the National Geographic magazine coming from America. Green, not literally green, that it doesn't mean literally greens, more trees. What it meant is that because Indian carbon footprint is the lowest compared to all the major economies of the world, So India is living most environmentally friendly life. Indians are living most environmentally friendly life in the world compared to China, Brazil, Russia, UK, France, Germany, USA, Canada, Mexico, and Australia, and so on. That is what it meant. I mean, it doesn't mean that India has more trees than other economies, other countries. But we need more trees, right? With all of us doing our job, our duties, I think we should be planting more trees. But we still have ways to go. Yes?
Yes, guys.
Yes, ma'am. So my question is, we have two perspectives. Like, since our school times, we have taught about the scientific sides of climate change and environment. And right now, I heard about the philosophical part of environmental conservation. So what I'm asking is, what do you think should be taught to us kids or the coming generation first, the philosophical way or the scientific way? Like, what should be the base?
I would say, I don't know if there is it needs to be prioritized in a way. Why can't it go simultaneously? Especially in the US and in the new education policy in India also, I think it's coming more and more that humanities are to be taught even to science students. So philosophy or religious studies, I think, is the best way to integrate with scientific studies also. So simultaneous study is what I would argue for, instead of saying this come first or that come first. Why can't we do both together? Ek subject science ka ho or ek subject philosophy, religion ka ho. We should all study all subjects. Why limit, especially at this young stage that you all are, all students, undergraduates, graduates, you should be open to all ideas, right? You have to study history, you have to study science, you have to study philosophy, religion, film studies, art history. Everything is to be grabbed as much as you can fill your mind with great information, great knowledge. This is the time to build your career. So, why even limit?
I know when you are in overseas, you would love to hear your hometown spoken language. So anyone who wants to address sir and make him feel comfortable at home, talking to him, you can go ahead, please.
Hindi mein pooch sakte hain, Hindi mein bol sakte hain, koi baat. Bilkul. Ji, yeah. Please.
Ma'am,
it's Salone. So I don't have a question. I just have a feedback. I'm a Jain, and I loved how elaborately you explained everybody like how we don't have meat and non-Jain. That was a clear explanation. How you nicely explained it.
So that helped when I mentioned the five categories, right? Taxonomy, one sense, two sense, three, four, five, right? Ekindriya.
It clearly made sense. Yeah.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Yeah, anyone? Yeah, Marina, go ahead, please. Marina?
Hello. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. I wanted to ask you. You mentioned that in some parts that the animal, man-eating tigers, the people don't kill them. Okay. They respect the nature. They want to preserve the nature. So, is it that the lives of people are not that important? Or no, I understand that they want to preserve the nature and living beings, but when it comes to our lives, how is it that they take this view on, like, not killing even if it hurts us?
Yeah, this is actually a mystery to me also. I would really be honest, I have not been to Sundarbans. Sundarbans is a part in West Bengal, so I have to figure out how to reach there. Sundarbans. But apparently that's what is happening there. There are mangroves. So inside the mangroves, there are humans living, and then there are tigers coming, and how they're actually living together is a mystery. It's really intriguing, one of the intriguing attractions that I have to go and see myself. But what I've heard is this, yeah, that Born BB, there are, you know, if you Google for Sundarbans and man-eating tigers and Born BB, you can find, that's what I've found, that because of the faith, and then there are Hindus and Muslims, mind you, it's not just Hindus, but Hindus and Muslims both revere Born BB, which lives apparently in Sundarbans. Born BB is forest goddess in Bengali. So because of forest goddess, nothing is to be hurt in the forest, right? No tigers to be hurt. And so there are crocodiles or alligators. I'm not sure. I have to do more research. But all the flora and fauna is to be kept intact in Sundarbans. Now, unfortunately, because of the industrialization, I think some years back, there was some controversy that more hotels should be opened in Sundarbans. And then thankfully, it was stopped. So there is some pressure from modernity or modernization or industrialization. But so far, Sundarbans are protecting the ecology of West Bengal. Because of Sundarbans, we have, I think, less effects such as tsunami on West Bengal. Otherwise, those mangroves are protecting the ecology of West Bengal. So it's a very, very interesting. Every part of India is so fascinating, so intriguing. You can never explore India in one lifetime. Many, many lifetimes you need. So I've made my mission to go to every part of India. I have been to almost every part of India except Sundarbans. And for a few more places are left, but I'm on a mission to explore entire India in terms of its ecology, its history, its cultural traditions. Especially you all being so young, you have full life ahead of you. Go and explore, write papers on Sundarbans, teach the world about Sundarbans. What is Sundarbans? Right? Teach the world about Bishnois, teach the world about Gir forest in Gujarat. Why? You should have this question, why lions are present only in India? Only in Gujarat, nowhere else except Africa. Why rhinoceros are present only in Assam, nowhere else in the world? What is so unique about India that we have preserved our wildlife so carefully? Yes, thank you for your question.
Next, on that line, there is something called a lived experience coming up also. So many of these researchers and scholars are trying to, as you rightly pointed out, how these imperial kind of categories are played to us, and yes, how these categories are again used to report and reach those kind of understandings. So the lived experience, as you said, Born Baby, is something like a category. So you try to explore amidst the living conditions of the people and understand how do they address their surrounding, their environment. So there are many scholars in India who are working on this, sir. So again, an opening for all our students.
Yes.
Get into the grassroots level and see how people are. So as you rightly said, it is very fascinating to know how people and communities are living amidst the nature. There is a kind of a variety in Northeast regions, in Assam, as you said, since I've been to Assam and Kaziranga. And
that's with the rhinoceros.
How they have actually, made their coexistence and cohabitation with the natural surroundings. Mm-hmm. So that is being explored a lot. So this is another opening, Marina, for you, if you're thinking of something like environmental philosophy or environmental consciousness as your future. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And my area has been environmental philosophy, sir. So my thesis is called environmental philosophy. So that's how I could really connect with when you said all these concepts and the minimalism idea that is coming from various perspectives, be it from Jainism or Hinduism or Buddhism or the world religions for that matter. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you. Yes.
Yes, sir. I have a question. I just want to know the reason why is Jainism not widely accepted as compared to other traditions like Hinduism and Buddhism? Is it because of their ascetic ideal, because of the rigidity? And I mean, what is it? Why is it not recognized just as like Hinduism and Buddhism? Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, the principles of Jainism have percolated, I think, in wider Indian population also, wider Hindu population and so on. Buddhism also became almost vanished from India when the Shankara started his movement of revival of Hinduism, more than 1,000 years ago. Buddhism had to also merge with Hinduism when Buddha was incorporated as the ninth incarnation of Vishnu. And then because of other events that were happening across northwest of India and northwest of South Asia, Buddhists had to leave India, and then Buddhists went to Tibet, from Tibet to China, China to Japan, and Theravada Buddhism went into Southeast Asia. So Buddhism mostly all disappeared from India. But Jainism survived in India, even as Buddhism vanished. But Jainism always remained a minority tradition within the land of what was Hind or Hindustan or now India. Because of the rigorous ascetic practices and many overlap with Hindu and Buddhist philosophy, so many ideas or many Jains have been calling themselves Hindus. So they don't even make this distinction, including me. So it's very hard to really gauge the number of actual Jains because, you know, they have no problem in calling themselves Hindu also. But still, yes, it has remained a minority religion because of the rigorous practice of asceticism and not easy to live with the fasting and the other rigorous practices that Jain saints have taught for millennia. Yes. Hope that answers the question. Yes. Nandita Murli Vasudevan has her hand up.
Yes, Nandita. Hello, sir. Yes, ma'am. I had a question about the Ahimsa part. So, is self-defense justified? Not only against self-defense from other humans, but self-defense from annoying insects like mosquitoes. Is that also not okay?
I think the idea, you are all philosophy students, so philosophically the idea is to minimize violence at every instance, right? So let's say a mosquito is bothering me. So one instinctual response can be killing the mosquito right there, right? The other response can be that I change my position. I move away from the mosquito, from that mosquito, and I try not to hurt that mosquito or myself, right? The other response can be that mosquito, let the mosquito not even enter the room where I'm sitting. So prevention of the violence, right? So it all goes, and if I did by instinct, I killed that mosquito in one instance, that should give me a lesson, that should give me some remorse, that next time I will try not to kill that mosquito and try to adopt my lesser violent means. It is always a journey, right? I think nobody is perfect. We're all on a journey. Even Gandhi was not, nobody's perfect. Gandhi was not perfect. Gandhi also evolved. And he, there was a big debate actually about cattle in Ahmedabad. So one cow was very sick in Ahmedabad. And Gandhi, imagine, you know, decades before euthanasia came into our lexicon, Gandhi said that that cow should be killed. If cow is suffering, just euthanize without using the word euthanize. Gandhi said, euthanize that cow, kill that cow. Because why should that cow suffer if it is going to die anyway? It is suffering from the disease. The Orthodox Jains were very upset. How can you disrupt a life cycle of a cow? Gandhi has no right in interfering the life trajectory of a cow, even of a cow. Let cow take its own course. Let karma decide the cycle of life for that cow. Now, which is right? Who is right? Is Gandhi right, or the Orthodox Jains who were opposing Gandhi? Were they right? Who has to decide? So it's an open debate, right? So what is our response to such suffering or such, like you said, violence? Or let's say if a tiger in Sundarbans is coming to kill me, what should I do? Should I kill the tiger? Should I move away from tiger? Should I prevent tiger somehow? These are all, you know, there is no easy yes or no answer. We all are evolving. We all have to just keep thinking that how can I minimize violence? If I'm eating a carrot, so an Orthodox Jain would say, no, don't eat carrot because carrot is the root of that plant. You're killing the entire plant. So if you're really hungry, instead of a carrot, maybe eat a mango. Mango, at least you're not killing the entire plant. You're just taking a byproduct of that plant. Or just take one banana instead of killing the entire plant, right? So, and then on certain days, let's say 8th or 14th day of the lunar month, go completely hungry, do complete fast. So avoid all kinds of violence towards a mango, towards a banana, towards even wheat, towards lentil. Avoid all kinds of violence, avoid complete food, go completely hungry, practice fasting. So that's the next step, right? As I said, it's a journey. So avoid carrot, then avoid vegetables, avoid even food. Avoid even water, because water is also living. Water also has soul. So really strict Jains would avoid even water when they're fasting, including my own grandmother. So it's always a journey. who has to decide who is right, who is wrong? It's always a journey. Hope that answers the question.
Shreya?
Yeah, Shreya.
Yes, ma'am. So, sir, I wanted to ask, is abortion ethical from the perspective of Jainism?
Okay, another sort of similar answer I would give that this I've watched in a documentary called Ahimsa. There is a documentary called Ahimsa on YouTube. You can watch it. It's a greatly made documentary by Michael Tobias in California. Now, thankfully, it's on YouTube. I'm not sure if it is legal or not. I don't know. But it is available now on YouTube. And in which a monk is saying that a late stage abortion is prohibited in across ethical traditions, across all religious traditions, because that is really violence, that is really killing of a child, right? But an early stage should be a choice for the mother. That is coming from a Jain monk. Now again, who is to decide this? These are all big ethical, open-ended questions, and I'm not the final word. Nobody is the final word, I think, on such issues, such questions. It's left to individual judgment, individual philosophical positioning. That is why I think philosophy as a subject has much to contribute. So it makes us think all these questions, right? There is no easy answer. We always have to keep thinking and keep applying different perspectives. Anekantvad, that is where Anekantvad comes in also, right? Is the health of that fetus more important? Health of the mother more important? Or honor of the family more important? What is more important? Who has to decide? So all of these perspectives we have to combine. That person has to combine and that take come up with the decision. No yes or no answer, I think. Right?
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Good morning, sir. It was a very nice talk. I quite enjoyed it. My question is, it's more like it's a little vague. Because when we talk about sustainability, the most crucial parts would be education, but also economy. Like, I think a big difference is that in America, a lot of people think that, you know, man is a superior being and therefore they deserve to eat meat. And whereas here, although we in India, we are leaving much less of a carbon footprint, but I think some of us don't have a choice. Like a lot of people, the lower classes and the lower income classes, they can't afford to own their own cars and things like that because our economy is not that good. So what's your opinion on this? Like, how do we improve it? Like, just the ethical perspective is not enough, right? So how do we incorporate it? Like, you can cover the education aspect, but what about the economy?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so right. So now I think time has come and people are already adopting the economy and ecology have to go together also, right? We cannot put economy first and ecology later, or ecology first and economy later for India's case, for example, I think, right? So I think there are now many, many green jobs are coming up, right? So, or renewable energy based choices are coming up also. So with more renewable energy based energy coming in, I think it will be more easier for so-called lower classes to go and own completely, you know, zero carbon footprint cars, for example. It would be possible, hopefully soon in near future. And if there is zero carbon footprint, then I think it's okay to go for example, electric cars. And if that car is being charged by renewable energy, then it should be okay. I think then economy and ecology can go together, and people would be able to afford these things without polluting their environment. Time has not yet come, even for America. Even here now, people have not adopted electric cars wholeheartedly because they are very, very expensive, and people are just have, you know, not so much acceptance for a car that is, you know, always limited by how many miles it can go on one charge and many other things. So it is still, again, I think, evolving, and more and more such alternative ideas as they become more widespread, more cheaper. Then I think the, you know, lifestyle and ecology and economy would all hopefully come in sync. It is still developing, I think. Hope that answers your question.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions, students?
All right, I think we'll stop now.
Yeah. So it was really a very interactive session, sir. And before ending it, as I would like to invite our another colleague, Professor Kamla ma'am, for vote of thanks, official vote of thanks. So Kamla ma'am, over to you. Yeah.
Thank you, Shikha. If I have to,
she's our techno guru, by the way. Oh. I call her my techno guru. Yeah,
that is an added tag. Okay. If I have one take-home message from your lecture, Dr. Jain, it is how, again, we look at life. I think so. For that, your lecture has given us a message on how we need to alter our attitude. Because I believe personally, attitude is the way we look at life. And therefore, it is a way you choose to see and respond to events, situations, people, and ourselves too. So therefore, as you said, the choice that you make is what is important. As a few of our students have asked this question regarding how do we balance economy, ecology, and how do we also. So we have a big challenge in India because we are an emerging economy and a developing country. We cannot compromise. We have to be still high on our, less of carbon footprint. Amidst all those challenges, as you pointed out through your talk, the minimalist approach, the cohabitation existence, all these are something which has been part of our culture. And ecology, culture, and religion goes a long, long way. So that's my take-home value. On that note, on behalf of the Department of Philosophy, on the behalf of our principal, Dr. Uma Shankar, and on my personal behalf, I would really like to extend my sincere and our sincere thanks to you for engaging us for almost like 1.5 hours, in spite of it being late night in US. Thank you for your time and your valuable input and enlightening us as well as our students onto this understanding of how in towards the sustainability goal that we globally are aiming towards, how can an Eastern religious perspective, which is Indian perspective on the sustainability goal, can add on to that value. And it can take us long, long way in conservation, preservation, and coexistence. Thank you very much for that, sir. This event couldn't have been possible because we have just now recently added our dear friend and colleague, Ms. Shikha Sharma, to our department. She's just recently joined 1 month ago. And when we were just trying to figure out the academic plan of the year, I just happened to ask her, can she bring in some kind of a known resource people whom she knows, whom she has interacted in the past. So she said very well, willingly she came forward. So thank you to Shikha to invite for us Dr. Jain and have a kind of a medium to interact with Dr. Jain and his knowledge, expertise that he has. And also thank you. I would really like to mention here, as Shikha mentioned in the opening remarks, without Uma ma'am's support and encouragement and this kind of healthy atmosphere that she has created for us in our department level or even at the institutional level, because she heads the institution too. So the kind of positive vibe that she has created, the kind of mutual interaction that we can approach her and ask for anything. So without her support, this could not be possible. Another mention about our management, which has very graciously given us this Microsoft Teams as a platform, not stopping us from engaging lectures and holding webinars like this, guest talks like this. So sincere gratitude and thank you to our management also, who has given us this platform to engage and connect virtually with our lectures, with our teaching, learning, evaluations, and hold such events in large scale. And lastly, not the least, my dear students, your presence, your involvement, your readiness to accept these invitations and readily be there for, on time and participate like this, interact, discuss, because these discussions are going to be something which is shaping your future life, your future choices. So attitude is the way of life today, my dear students. So on that hope, many more such lectures we are going to engage. And I would again like to remind you, Dr. Jain, that we would really want to welcome you once you are in India and you are in our neighborhood in Pune. We would really love to have you at SIS and we will personally interact. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, for making this.
Ma'am, can we take a group photo before we end? With the students, with us.
Yes, and it is accessible. So students, you can switch on your camera. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you for that, Shikha. Yeah.
Yeah. We can you have to take the photo because,
We are, students, can request you to switch on your camera, please. Students, you have the access now. Yeah.
Pranav, Riya, please switch on your cameras. Nandita, Marina.
Very nice if you do that. Yeah. I can see slowly students are doing it. Yeah. Still not many more.
Yes, very good.
Some more? Anushka, Riya. Okay.
Sean, yeah. Abhishek.
What about Abhishek? Pranav is there. Kushi, Akansha. Personal invitation, yeah? Elena, I can see Elena. Okay, there we go. Say cheese, everyone. Some more, still joining? Okay. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Jain. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
TY students, I think so. I can have your Plato's lecture scheduled. With the psychology, I'm readjusting at 2 o'clock, so see you all at 2 o'clock.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you.
Bye-bye. See you at 2.